We decided to take the next few days off filming and just relax, especially with how emotional I got at the thought of maybe having to leave the village. We did get some quite funny little videos of us walking around and about, which will be coming up, along with some little videos of us all looking through the tabletop map that Carl lent us.
Right, this is where we are. This is where we're set. This is the square. Quite good, there's always something going past. Tractor or a digger or whatever. That is Tonka's. A bit of everything. Shop, bar. And then Linda's office is down there. All in all, quite sunny, quite nice. Slightly overcast, but not too bad. The sun's behind them trees. And that's that. Right, we're walking back, heading back now to our little house.
You want to rest?
And this here, this is Linda's office. And down this road, this is where the house is. Leo says he's tired. Tell us how tired you are. Still tired.
Oh, cutting his legs up, ready for winter.
Yeah. Are you still tired? Yeah. These are some of the lesser travelled Bulgarian roads.
Don't stay away from that.
Because it's hot. Got a little bonfire there, look. Well, we know now what was burning. Yeah, this is our walk. We do this a couple of times a day. So it's actually quite a nice walk, really. We've not had any incidents. Here you are. And this would be us. That one's locked.
Tonight, we are visually looking at the moon.
But the moon keeps moving across the sky, so I'm having to make adjustments to the scope.
Me.
No. Just wait a minute. No, you can't lean on the table. That's probably what did it before.
Gone. Again.
It's because he keeps leaning on it.
Again.
It's because you're a little bit little and you're not holding on to Daddy's arms. You've got to lean on Daddy's arms and not touch the telescope. Can you see it? What can you see?
Moon.
Can you see the moon?
Yeah, it's keep moving.
It will move.
Does it keep moving?
Yeah.
Well, there you have it, folks. The moon keeps moving. Once Leo was happy and had had a look at the moon, we got him to bed, and then me and Rick were up most of the night looking at different things in the sky, as well as him doing his gradings. Last night was amazing. We got the little Mach 127 out that Carl from Caravello Space Center graciously lent us, and thank you very much, Carl, if you're watching this. I cannot put into words how awe-inspiring and jaw-dropping seeing things with my own eyes. I mean, as most of you will probably know by now, Rick's vision isn't fantastic. He only has his right eye, which is quite funny to say that he can actually see more when it comes to the night sky than I can. So for me to be able to actually look through a telescope and see something, it's like winning the lottery for me. I saw the nebulosity around Orion. I saw the trapezium inside Orion, the cone of Orion, Betelgeuse and all its amazing star burst spike spectacularity. We saw Jupiter and its four and four of its moons with my eye through a telescope. That is just, oh my god, amazing. So after doing that all last night, we have made the decision that we are going to purchase the land here in Lesovo, and we are going to settle here. Does Rick want better skies? Yeah, but after seeing what we saw last night on a full moon, which was right above us, and streetlights around us, he is over the moon at what could be once we get the two lights out on the property that we're looking at. And then obviously you don't do any observing and things on full moons anyway. So he's now really, really excited for the prospects of what's going to happen. Many of you have been asking why sky quality is such a big thing for us. Here in the UK, Rick's quite an avid astrophotographer. He has always wanted to build quite a large observatory. So when we decided to make the move over to Bulgaria, he decided that everyone from anywhere in the world should be able to witness the amazing dark skies that Bulgaria has to offer. So we are going to make his dream a reality. Rick has been researching and doing everything he can in the background with designing websites and things. And hopefully over the next 2 years, we will have a fully fledged, first of its kind radio and visual observatory. Anyone in the world will be able to connect to visually look at stars, photograph stars, absolutely anything. Hope this helps and clarifies a few things for people.
I thought I'd elaborate a little bit on what Sara's been discussing regarding the observatory and the infrastructure, and also she's mentioned radio interferometry. That is something still looking into. I need to conduct some sort of a survey and see how we are in the way of interference. Just to avoid any confusion, specifically when it comes to the optical aspect of the telescope array, I thought I'd take this time just to share a few images we've been able to capture from our Bortle 5 skies in the UK. Producing these images isn't simply a case of just pointing the telescope at the sky and pressing a button and hoping for the best. Some can take a week, a month, 4 months, 5 months, it varies depending on what we're trying to do. The East and West Veil Nebula image, for example, is a mosaic that took me about 4 months to acquire the data for. As soon as data acquisition is complete, the images themselves, or the data rather, still needs to be processed. That can take anything from 3 or 4 hours to 12 hours, again, depending on the size of the data set. So the data sets that we've taken in the past consist of hundreds, if not thousands, of individual images. The Rosette Nebula, one of the most iconic star-forming regions in the night sky, is located over 5,000 light-years away in the constellation Monoceros, the Unicorn. With nearly 8 hours of exposure time, you can see the intricate detail in the swirling gas and dust, forming what looks like the petals of a cosmic rose. Every one of those dark filaments is a nursery for new stars, some of which could one day have their own planets, maybe even life. This image captures the breathtaking expanse of the Veil Nebula, a supernova remnant in the constellation Cygnus. Spanning over 100 light years, the Veil is a glowing aftermath of a massive star that exploded approximately 10,000 years ago. On the left, the East Veil Nebula, with its intricate filaments of ionized hydrogen and oxygen gas glowing vibrantly. On the right, the West Veil Nebula, also known as the Witch's Broom, sweeps dramatically across the starscape. Together, these celestial structures tell a story of celestial destruction and rebirth. As the remnants of the explosion continue to expand and enrich the interstellar medium. This image brings both halves of the stunning nebula into one frame, revealing the intricate nature of this ancient stellar event. Next, we have the Heart Nebula, named for its unmistakable shape. It's almost like the universe is sending us a message of love. this glowing region, over 7,000 light years away in the constellation Cassiopeia, is a hotspot for star formation. The bright, intricate structures you see are carved by powerful winds and radiation from massive young stars. This image took over 14 hours to capture, but seeing all of the vibrant hydrogen gas and detail makes it so worth it. This image captures a rare event, Comet C2022E3ZTF, passing by the faint spiral galaxy NGC 5894. Comets are like time capsules, carrying material from our early solar system. This one hasn't been seen in about 50,000 years. Meanwhile, NGC 5894 is over 100 million light years away. The light we see from it now began its journey as flowering plants were starting to evolve on Earth. The Sol Nebula, IC 1848, is a stunning star-forming region about 7,500 light years away in the constellation Cassiopeia. This image, with over 16 hours of integration time, reveals vibrant hues of ionized gas and intricate dust lanes, showcasing the nebula's role as a celestial nursery where new stars are born. This is M101, the Pinwheel Galaxy, a spiral galaxy that sits around 21 million light years away. What makes this image different? The bright spot near its edge, a supernova called SN 2023 IXF. This is a star that has reached the end of its life in a spectacular explosion, releasing more energy in a few weeks than our sun will in its entire lifetime. With around 4 hours of exposure time, it's a snapshot of one of the most dramatic events in the cosmos. Here's a view of the Cygnus star cloud, home to the Tulip Nebula. This area of sky in the constellation Cygnus is packed with stars and glowing hydrogen gas. With over 15 hours of exposure time, you can see the subtle areas and curves that give the Tulip Nebula its name. The region of the Milky Way, so rich with detail, you could spend hours exploring it. The Andromeda Galaxy, our cosmic neighbour, is 2.5 million light years away. On a clear night, you can actually see it with the naked eye. With over 21 hours of integration time, this picture reveals its spiral arms, dense core, and some of its satellite galaxies. One day, billions of years in the future, Andromeda will merge with the Milky Way to form a completely new galaxy. The Lion Nebula, one of the faintest and most challenging targets I've ever captured. It's located in the constellation Cepheus. Its subtle detail demand patience. 55 hours of exposures went into this target. Capturing 55 hours worth of data in the UK is exceedingly difficult, so I partnered with a friend in order to be able to capture that amount of data in a time that was reasonable, shall we say.
Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe to follow us on our journey. A massive thank you to everyone who already has liked and subscribed and is now following our journey. If you haven't already, head on over to our Facebook page, Midlands to Mountains, which is also in the description, to get live updates when our next episode is out. Alternatively, you can just click the bell to get notified via YouTube.